Hey guys, Mark Lewis here. I'm here to show you how I would use STL Tone Hub in a full mix or a full production, and what the sounds I've dialed up sound like. This is from a song from the new Havoc record called V. It's actually out May 1st, and the name of the song is Interface with the Infinite. We'll do kind of an instrumental version so you guys can really zero in on how the guitars are sounding. I'll show you the rhythm guitars with it and then a lead section as well. This is preset number 16. It's actually my Driftwood Purple Nightmare through an Engl 412 with 65-watt Celestion Creambacks, mic'd up with an SM57 through my Neve 1073. This is pretty similar to the album tone, very similar setup, and this one just sits in the mix amazingly. And to me, it just sounds like the real thing. Cool, so there you go. It's super easy, super happy with that sound. Something I would absolutely use. I think it sounds every bit as good as what we dialed in on the record, and really just feels great too. It's got the dynamics I need. It doesn't sound overly compressed like a lot of plugins do. Really happy with this. All right guys, now I want to show you how powerful this this EQ section is in the Tone Hub. Basically, you're able to really get completely mix ready tones inside of the plugin, and I was really happy with actually how the EQ sounded in this. I could easily mix guitars in here, and every rhythm preset in this, as well as leads, but the rhythm has the same EQ on each preset for you to be able to adjust to make it mix ready using my settings and what I think really makes it sit in the mix the best. Let's make the plugin a little bigger so you can see it. Here we have the EQ section, and we'll start with the high pass. I normally go up to about, for a rhythm, anywhere between 65 and, or 63 and 70 hertz. This one we'll do, let's say 66. And then the low pass will go up to 12K, which is pretty standard. Most mixers are doing something like that to kind of get the fizziness and the low end gunk out. And then one of the key things I do, and one of the things I'll say about this, is that I made these profiles purposely really big sounding, especially in the low end, because I feel that if you get it tight and a little big on the way in, it's much easier than trying to add it with EQ. It never really works with me like that. So what I do is I'll take a low shelf, take it down to maybe about 240, 250, and it's a shelf, not a bell. It's the important thing. And we take that down about a dB and a half to start. And then if you want to further get some gunk out, I might go down to around 500, maybe even in the 330s. This one will do 500. I'm not gonna do any gain reduction on that yet. And then if you want to make something brighter, I tend to use a high shelf at about 2K. I won't do anything on that yet. I'm gonna go ahead and show you guys what this sounds like in EQ in real time. There we go. Here, that gets some of the gunk out. And then here's the low end curve that I have. That makes it quite a bit tighter, easier to sit in the mix. You can adjust that however you like. Obviously, you can get really thin or get really big. I find the sweet spot is between 1 and 2 dB, depending on what your mix sounds like. The gunk here, this one sounds like this. Get a little more of a scoop sound, less boxy, if you want more kind of a vintage mid-range. Boost it, or cut it, however you like. This is the high frequency to make it brighter if you need. Kind of a broad stroke, but sounds really good. Doesn't sound overly EQ'd to my ear. I'll start from the top and turn it off completely. makes it quite a bit more tailored for the mix to me, pretty much mix ready. Every rhythm preset will have this EQ starting point for you, so you can really dial things in very easily. I think a lot of people get presets and they might sound great on their own, but they don't know where to start to make them sound great in the mix, and I think this is a great start. It should be just about all you need to really dial it in. You know, it's my suggestions, what I would do. Sounds amazing to me. Now I want to talk to you a little bit about the speaker cabinet section. Surprisingly, incredibly realistic. You have your distance, you have your angle, which are very critical, the most critical points of cab placement, and the speaker position, which I'll show you last. The distance, you know, kind of mimics proximity effect. Let's check this out. Here, as I increase the distance, we lose low end, which is exactly pretty much what you'd lose in real life. Get a little less focus, a little less punch in the lows. And then the angle here is pretty critical in how you want to tailor your high end and really, really, really spot on with how it actually sounds. You see the mic moving. We're losing from about, especially that 10K area, even the high mids get much creamier and darker. And back to stock here. And the resonance control is really cool. Can give you a lot more punch and a lot more high end if you need it, something that you can't get with conventional mic placement. I find it really useful. Almost sounds kind of pre-EQ'd. Very punchy low end, something you can't get by moving a mic like that. Really cool control. Then we have the high and low pass, which is pretty much the same as what we have in the EQ. Extra bit of control there, sounds really great. And then finally, we have the mic position, which is really, really great. I mean, I normally think about mic positioning on how I want to tailor my high end, low end. You're really not getting much more low end when you move a mic as much as you're kind of canceling out high end. So we'll start here where it picks it up, which is very realistic. That's about where I had the mic on the actual profile. So let's check this out. We'll go from center all the way to the edge, and then I'll move it around so you can see how the different speaker positions affect the tone. See that? Much more 10K. Decreasing. Pretty much exactly how it would sound. Especially if I'm sitting in here with a Dynamount, moving it via remote control. Really cool. Very realistic. And then back to stock about right there. Sounds amazing to me. Okay guys, now I want to show you a clip where I'm using the tone hub on a lead section. We'll go to the solo in the same song. I'm using a different amp, different miking, different boost pedal, everything. This is a Rhodes Colossus on channel 4 through the angle cabinet, 65 watt creambacks through my Neve 1073, mic'd up with a 57. I'll also touch on the EQ. I do a little bit different EQing on the lead presets. Most of them, I go up a little higher on the high pass, maybe up to 100 or 110, depending. And then I might go all the way up to 10, even 8, depending on how creamy I want the lead sound to be. This one will do 10, and for continuity's sake, we'll keep the low frequency tailoring about the same. I'm not going to boost any high end on this one. I don't feel that it needs it. We'll have this on. It should sit in the mix really well. All right, guys, let's check this one out. We'll be right back. Excellent. Love it.